Hey everyone, this is Brad Chmielewski. I'm back with another episode of Shatter The Vain. So it's been an awesome week of Vainglory. Double glory weekend happened. We'll talk about more of that in the news, but been playing a lot. I've been trying to kick out some more videos up on the YouTube channel. That's at youtube.com/Shatter The Vain, so check that out. Trying to do some fun stuff that's not always working out. I think there's a Support Fox video that's either up there or coming out soon that took me a while to get through, and a lot of AFKers in my games, people getting mad at me for trying it. But I was, come on guys, I was in casuals. Like, those are meant to be the places to try stuff, to have fun, right? It seems like the game is growing a lot. We had the EU live finals happening. Gotta watch the VODs. I didn't catch them all. I caught a few of the games, but I'll be sure to catch those and, you know, see what happened. You gotta see how these players are doing, learn the names, and root for your teams. Always good. So check out those VODs on the YouTube, on the Twitch channel. Hopefully they put them on YouTube. And so on this episode, I got Lotz joining me. Lotz is the head coach of Liberation. So as you all know, Liberation X just won North American Life Finals the other weekend. What, 2 weeks ago now? Congratulations to them again, and fun to get a little insight onto, what the coaches do for the team, what they think of the team. The players are a big star of the game, and they're the ones getting the kills and winning the games, but there's a lot that's done behind the scenes too, to make sure they don't make some of the mistakes they do, and the picks and the comps and all that stuff. So get good insight of what's happening there. And then Christmas is coming up. Keep coming these episodes out every week. I don't think we'll take a break like we did last year. I got one guest coming up. I know Hot Mess and Odds, and then we got some other people lined up and talking to as well. And then I want to mention again the Patreon channel. That's over at patreon.com/shatterthevain. If you're liking the show, I appreciate everyone listens to me. Emails I get at shatterthevain@gmail.com, and on Twitter, everyone talking to me. It's fantastic. I love the growth of this, but do all this for free. So if you can donate, go over there. We can do more with the show. We can make it even better, bigger, maybe more shows, more videos on YouTube, maybe more guides, all that fun stuff. So check that out. So let's get into this episode. Yeah, get ready for some great information from Lotz. Here we go.
Shatter the Vain, a podcast about vainglory.
This is the 67th episode of Shatter the Vain. My name is Brad Chmielewski, and this is a podcast all about vainglory. Every week, I try to break down the news, gameplay, game tips, and hopefully we can all become better players together. And every week, I'm bringing on new people within the community, people that love the game, love vainglory, love MOBAs in general. And this week, I have Lotz joining me. Welcome.
Hey, guys. What's up? I'm Lotz. I'm the head coach of Liberation. I'm really happy to join.
Yeah, this is awesome that got you on, and shortly here after the live finals. So
for sure.
Yeah, couldn't even ask for a better time to have you here.
Yeah, for sure.
So you're the head coach. How'd you get into Vainglory? Like, what made this your MOBA of choice at the moment?
So my junior year of high school, my high school gave us iPads.
Okay.
And so I was constantly like just bored in class, and I went in the app store, I saw Vainglory, and I played League and a little bit of Heroes of the Storm before. Okay. I was like, I'll try it out. So I downloaded it, and it wasn't blocked on my school's internet, so I just constantly played it during class, and I got like addicted to it, and I got all my friends into it. And then after a while, my whole school was playing, and I kind of just got hooked from there.
Oh, that's awesome. You just fell in love with the game that way. Were you on a guild or a team at that point, or were you just kind of like playing with your friends in the school?
I mean, way back then, there wasn't like a lot developed. Because to my knowledge, like the only region that Vainglory was actually in was Thailand or like the East Asian region. And so like there was nothing really developed yet for North America. So it was kind of just me playing with my friends.
Oh, cool. Okay. Yeah, we didn't have the NA launch until like it was November-ish, so just celebrated the year not too long ago.
For sure.
That's cool. Who were you playing a lot of when you first got into it?
I mean, I think it's kind of like a similar answer for everybody, but mostly Ringo.
Okay.
Because, you know, they start you on Ringo, and I was like, oh, this guy's cool. He has a gun, and he's missing an arm and stuff. And I...
Oh, did your audio cut out? Oh,
hello?
Yeah, now you're back. Okay.
Is it fixed?
Yeah.
I don't know what's happening.
Or now it sounds like it's your system audio. Okay.
I don't know. Yeah. All right. My bad.
Oh, okay. No problem. I can hear you.
All right. Cool. I don't know what just happened. Like, everything just shut down.
Oh, weird. Okay. Ask again. We'll start off with, like, who you were playing.
Sure.
So who, when you first got into it, who did you start playing a lot of? Like, who was your main?
I mained Ringo for a really long time because I just really liked his playstyle, and they kind of just start you out with Ringo, but yeah. I played a lot of Jewel too.
Okay. Jewel, like, I remember when Jewel came out, I was like, I don't have enough gold to get her, and I don't want to put money on this weird Southeast Asia iTunes account that I'm not sure about.
Right.
So that's fun. So how do, I guess, Liberation then happen? Like, what changed from when you were playing in the Southeast Asia server to the NA launch to now this team? Like, even before maybe being the head coach?
So, like, when I first started playing, I was, like, playing really casually. I didn't think it would ever, like, get this far, you know? Like, Vainglory is a game. Like, not gonna lie, I didn't think it would be this big competitive esport. And I took like a really long break from it because I just wanted to focus on other games and school and stuff like that.
Okay.
And I come back and there's like, you know, there's an infrastructure for competitive play and stuff like that. But I felt like I was just way too far behind like all the pro players, or I guess pro players at the time, there weren't really any.
Sure.
And so I kind of like, I mean, I realized I had the knowledge for the game like really down because, I mean, I've played MOBAs and strategy games and stuff like that before.
Yeah.
And so I kind of just like went into like the subreddit and just said, hey, I'm doing personal coaching sessions for, you know, like low elos or something like that.
Oh, cool.
And then it started from low elos, and then all of a sudden, like, you know, polo players were coming to me. I had like two or three Vainglorious people come to me, and this is before I was really known.
Oh, wow.
So it was a pretty big deal for me. And I kind of just worked through that. I joined Vertigo as a team coach.
Okay.
And that was really cool because I really got to like explore what I could do for a team. But, you know, some things happened, and I don't really go into full detail into that, but I ended up splitting away from them and, you know, working on smaller teams so I could be more of a team leader.
When you're coaching someone, are you watching their game? Are you doing, like, we'll record it, and then we'll talk about it afterwards on stream? How does that work out?
Okay, yeah. So for personal coaching, it kind of ranges. Like, if I don't think, like, okay, with decent-ish, not bad, you know, like, really, really low elo, it's not really their gameplay, because like at that point they need to work on everything. It's not just small things they need to work on, like, you know, a Vainglorious player. It's everything. So usually they're just missing some key fundamentals, and that's when I do vocal lessons, because I can just sit down for an hour, maybe even 2 hours, and just, you know, talk to them and, you know, let them ask all these questions, and I can answer them and, you know, explain some like fundamentals that I think every player needs to know.
Oh, cool. Okay.
Yeah.
What's like one thing you've seems to always come up that you tell people, like, every game, like a one little tip you could tell everyone right here, all those low elo people.
One tip is really gauge like how valuable that kill you're about to get really is. Is it worth diving their team 1v3 to get that kill?
It's always worth it, man.
Right? Always worth it. Or is it okay to die? Because there's another side of the coin for that is some people just don't want to die. But sometimes it's worth dying, you know? So just gauge the value on deaths and kills.
Okay. So that's personal. And then so you got into the team after Vertigo. How's the team coaching go? Are you like in the spectator and just kind of scrimming against people?
Okay. With team coaching, like it started out with Vertigo. I was more like focused on like gameplay and stuff like that. But the more teams I went through, the more I focused on like, you know, mindset and stuff like that. And like, not necessarily gameplay issues, but more so team issues and kind of like the macro of everything.
Okay. Nice. So you did that for a while, and then you went to these smaller teams and organizations. Like, was that about the time Liberation started? Like, I don't remember like exactly when they started. They just kind of appeared on the scene all of a sudden.
Right. So Liberation, we have this thing now. It's called the Legendary 43rd Seed. And the reason behind that is because they did join VGL, and they were like a group of guys who, you know, hung out with Status Bake. They were related to Status Bake, and they decided to make a team, make a guild.
Okay.
So they joined VGL. They're 43rd seed. And then you had Status Bake, who was in Lucky 13.
Right.
And we all know about Lucky 13 and Liberation. They got the DQ. Apparently, there's a rumor, like they said that Status Bake was playing multiple accounts, but. What ended up happening there was, I guess there were some issues in Lucky 13 because I was with them for about a week before we got disqualified because I was doing the coaching application. And then once we got disqualified, everybody disbanded from Lucky 13 and moved over to Liberation.
Okay.
So all these really good players moved over there and it just spiked up in like skill power and stuff like that. And so now you have, you know, the best team in North America right now.
Right. Okay. That's awesome. So disqualified in that first qualifier, and then Liberation came back and got enough points and high enough ranking in the second qualifier to make it to our Autumn Live Finals that happened. It was 2 weeks ago now. Did you make it out there to that?
Yeah, I was actually there because it worked out that they lived in California, and so two of the players drove 6 hours, and I was really grateful for that.
SCMC was supplying us 4 tickets for everyone to fly out.
Oh, cool.
So yeah, it ended up working really well.
Yeah, so it seemed like everyone who was playing in that team from Liberation was there. All 6 members. People were flying out the final day, and so that's super exciting. Was there any doubt in your guys' mind that you were going to make it to Sunday?
Oh yeah, like as soon as we realized that Tigers wasn't going to make it because of the SAT, everybody's like, oh, we're not even going to make it to the second day, you know, we're in the DQ, you know, or not the DQ, but like just lose and like not make it to the semifinals. And I mean, I think that's like normal for players to think because, you know, when you play competitively, you have to be like hypercritical and like you know, realistic with yourself. And but I had faith.
Nice. So you were trying to keep them all together, hype them up, and keep them going there. And they're like, "You guys got it. You guys."
Yeah.
If you missed those live finals, you probably know by now Liberation won. SMC puts it all over the news and tweets it out. It's hard to avoid any of that. So what was it like at the live finals, at this event?
It was amazing. It was like really stressful because, you know, I was constantly just like looking at the screen and like, oh my God, what's going to happen type of thing. But overall, I mean, SMC did a great job. You know, like a bunch of free food, bunch of free dinners and stuff like that. That was really fun. And then overall, the venue was just like really hype. Like the crowd was honestly a lot better than I thought it was going to be because, you know, Vainglory is smaller still. And I thought like maybe the turnout wouldn't be that big, but it was actually really good. And I don't know, it was a really well orchestrated event.
Watching it here from home, I was like, oh, I was tuned in. I was watching. I had my phone in case I walked away from my computer. Right. So it was important. So as you guys got to that final match, I think it was pretty exciting that you guys almost got knocked out by Nemesis Hydra and then were able to come back and pull out that like reverse.
Yeah, it was insane. I don't know. I think what that really came down to was refreshing everybody's mindset. And the team, like, we were up on the, like, stair area. Like, there was this upstairs area. And we're talking, and we're like, look, we need to do, like, a roster swap here. Because when we put in Marto, you just saw everybody's face kind of, like, change a little bit. They were really down, and then all of a sudden they just started feeling better. And I think it was kind of like you had a different feel for things, you know? And it was really a big morale boost. And I think it really contributed to everybody's mood and like winning and stuff like that. So it was really amazing to see.
Right. So yeah, was anyone upset about these roster swaps? Like everyone got to play and like were people like kind of, you know, disappointed that they didn't perform or maybe felt like they didn't do as well to get swapped out or anything like that? Was it just kind of like, it's your turn?
Yeah.
All right.
Well, I mean, I think it's like, especially in the finals, I think it's really understandable to be a little upset for getting swapped out. Because obviously, yes, morale boost is one of the reasons we would do a swap. And then another is, yes, maybe someone was underperforming. And then it just never feels good. But I think it's really important. If you're going to play competitively, you just have to realize that sometimes you underperform, and when you do, you need to look at improving it, you know? So when Don got swapped out, that's what I tried to tell him. And, you know, there was definitely some aggression on both ends, but I think we got it smoothed out pretty well. I think he understood where everybody was coming from on the swap.
Oh, nice. Okay. So what's it like, I guess, coaching Status Big, who's the number one player in NA? Like, how's he, like, do you have advice for him? Does he just look for ways to improve? Like, is he open to that? Like,
Yeah, that's a big question I get, and, you know, it's always like, well, they're the number one or, like, number fifth, like, player in North America and then, like, some of the best players in the world. So why do they need a coach? And that's where, like, I had to adapt with Liberation, because before, like, with other teams, I really had to focus on gameplay because there was, like, huge gameplay mistakes they would make. But, you know, with Tigers and Status Peak especially, like, they don't really make that many mistakes. And when they do, they notice them. It's not, like, something I have to tell them. And so that just made my job easier, but it also gave me inspiration to, like, adapt my coaching style. And so I really focus on, you know, being kind of like a devil's advocate of the group to prevent group thought and kind of just, like, provide new scenarios of thought and stuff like that, and really focus on, like, yes, if there was a big team mistake or I think we need to be doing this better, I'll say something. But I'm basically another voice for them to consider over time. Then alongside that, it is like making sure they're not tilting, or when they are tilting, just to bring them back up and stuff like that.
Yeah, nice. So I guess stepping back from it, did you grow up coaching? Were you a coach in other sports and just, or did you just fall, like, get into it for Vainglory?
I didn't do too much, like, team coaching before. Most of my coaching resided in Magic the Gathering. I played that competitively, and so I would, like, help people, like, some of my friends. I started off with friends, and then I met people at local stores, and, you know, I'd go online and, like, coach them through games and, like, draft pick decisions, like, when they're drafting. So that's where it really started. But I also coached, like, a little bit of team coaching in Call of Duty, but I don't really count that.
Okay. Yeah. So you seem to like the coaching more than actual gameplay. Do you play a lot still of Vainglory?
I play Vainglory, but it's definitely more casual on my part. I do it mostly for, like, if I want to test something, like, see if something works.
Okay.
And then also just, like, to keep up with it. But I found really, really quickly that I'm just not a professional player, you know? That's just not where I reside, you know?
Yeah, I think it's a tough struggle for some people to realize, like, as you're climbing or as you're going, it's like there are humps, and if you're not improving, maybe this isn't the game. Like,
for sure,
you hate to break that to people, but sometimes it's like, yeah, you're good at the game, but you're not, you know, a pro player.
And then, like, what I like always talk about is people, like, are like, oh, you're not even that good, like, why are you coaching players? And I'm like, this is just, anybody can honestly go into coaching, I think. I just think there's certain things that people just need to learn to get better at it. I think really anybody who has, like, a good mindset of a game and a good mindset for, you know, group management can go into coaching.
Uh-huh.
So I don't think it's, like, this amazing thing that I'm doing, but I think I'm really lucky to have the opportunity to work with Liberation.
Mm-hmm. So what's next for Liberation now that won the live finals? Like, what's the team working on, or, like, any inside information you want to share?
I don't know how much in depth I could go right now. I'm not going to go too far. But we were doing some management on our B team, or Y, Liberation Y. So I'm really looking forward to that. I think they're going to come out, because I kind of felt bad for them this VGL, because they kind of got left in the dust by, you know, kind of the team in general, because we're really focused on the main roster. But we're really developing that now, and I think you're going to see a lot of players pop up and get more recognition through that.
Do you think the VIPL is going to, I guess, maybe invite you guys or open up some more slots? Like, do you see that as a possibility? Like, if,
you know, I don't really know how all that works. I was talking to people about that, and I kind of just trying to figure that one out too. I think there's a really good chance, but I think it depends on how they do it. Like, if they do the winner of this VGL live finals and then the winner of the next VGL live finals get invited or something like that.
Yeah.
Because technically it is a year from now. So I don't really know about VIPL, but I know that we're definitely going to do that infamous World Series tournament in January. That's going to be kind of, I want that to be a practice tournament for us. You know, get some like practice in for the next VGL. So right now we have our eyes set kind of sort of on that, but mostly on the next VGL and then VIPL.
Right, so the VGL is probably going to start sometime early or mid-January here when the season two kicks off, I'm sure.
Yeah.
So eyes on getting better and, you know, improving those teams. Right. All right. I'm sure some other secret things that you guys have developing.
Maybe. I don't know.
Did the interest in Liberation like just explode as you guys got closer? Like,
oh,
everyone wanted to join? And
yeah, like every day we just get friend requests from just random people. Like even I do. I'm not even really that well known from Liberation, you know? Like everybody knows, you know, Tiger's status, but like lots. Like nobody even knew me at the live event. And so it's just really weird to see all these like friend requests. And it's just because you're in Liberation. It's, I don't know. Yeah.
Right.
We got a lot of recognition. I think we ended up getting like 120 followers just off of winning live finals, which was pretty huge.
Nice. That's good. So if people do want to, do you let people apply or you kind of find talent? Like if someone's thinking of wanting to join or be part of Liberation in either competitive or any form that you guys sort of have.
Right now we do have applications open. I don't know how flexible, because I'm totally in charge of that. I'm kind of in charge of the when the players are actually accepted and, you know, are going to play competitively. That's when I kind of, like, take the reins. But right now, yeah, we do have an application process that we, like, freshly opened. But we also do, you know, if we think you're good and we think that you need to be more well-known or you have potential to play, we definitely look for those people just by ourselves.
Okay, nice. Yeah, so probably just keep playing in rank and maybe apply and then hope you get noticed.
I would definitely suggest apply because we're a lot more flexible when we see people, you know, show interest and like, you know, really want to join.
Yeah. That's awesome. Yeah. It seems like the talent there and the pool of people like just keeps growing.
Yeah,
see,
it's
like,
crazy.
Either new people join up, check friends that are in the guild. It's like, oh man, that guy's in there now.
Yeah. It's really cool.
Nice. So, anything else about Liberation or the live finals that you have to say, or should we jump in the news?
I guess I would like to say thank you for everybody that's been like supporting us even like after the DQ and before the DQ. Like, I think that's really important to everybody because we do care about our image and we really care about like how much support we're getting, and it's just really nice to see.
Yeah, so yeah, it's great that you guys came back from that disqualification. It didn't shake you. I know a lot of other guilds or a lot of people just would have been like, screw this, I don't want to be a part of this, like we're out, let's start our own thing. So that's good that you guys were able to like, I guess, shake that off and, you know, come out ahead on it.
For sure.
That's awesome. I'm looking forward to the next live finals. Hopefully I'll be able to make it out there. It should be sometime, what, if seasons last 3 months, what, January, February, March, right? Should be the next live finals.
March should be the next one.
Yeah, and I think Vainglory is going to do maybe a better job at announcing it sooner so people can get tickets ahead of time and not feel like, oh, I'm so rushed, and do I go and spend the money? But I could plan a trip around it or head out there too. So just keep a lookout for that. But let's jump into the news.
Vainglory News.
So the first thing in the news, gotta mention, is the 1.12 update that dropped. Drizzy and I did an entire patch rundown, episode 66. Go back and listen to that if you really want to like go in depth in that. But how's 1.12 been for you so far?
1.12 has been really interesting. Kestrel just came out, and I mean, I personally think she's just flat out broken. I think she's super duper strong, but she's kind of like Sky after, because Sky got buffed, right? And we didn't really see a lot of people playing her. Like, we saw a couple of teams trying to try her out, but they didn't really do too well. And she just had to find her spot in the meta and like comps and stuff like that. And I think that's where Kestrel is, but I think Kestrel is like really strong right now. So that just caught my eye like big time. And I think she's been really annoying to play against and kind of sort of play with because she has a really weird play style.
That attack speed that she gets is kind of nuts, and you like underestimate sometimes the damage. It's like that arrow did that much damage, that glimmer shot, and it splashed, and no way did that hit me.
and she stunned me and my whole team, and she was invisible, so there's like zero counterplay. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I think the most important thing to know playing against her, as soon as she goes invisible, just don't chase her. Like, wherever she went invisible, like, get out of that spot.
Yeah, exactly.
But I haven't got to play too much of her. I played, like, a couple games, but been a lot of, like, quick insta-lock things about her. And then it's kind of died down a little bit. I don't know if people are just like, oh, I don't want to play her or don't have her. But there's either one on both sides or there's no Kestra at all. It's kind of funny.
Yeah, I think people are like, a similar thing happened with Sky. And everybody just, like, sucked at Sky. You know, like, mm-hmm. I didn't see, like, one good Sky when she was released. And so I think, like, what people are starting to realize is Kestrel is, like, kind of hard to play. So, you know, you just see people just not do too well on her, and they're like, maybe I should have played Kestrel right now. I'll just wait till she gets buffed again, and she'll be OP, and I'll play her then.
Right. I can't see her getting buffed for 1.13. No. Like, if anything, she maybe tuned down a little bit. Sure.
For sure. But there's, like, always the joke with, like, Rona, Sky, I don't know about Vox, but they, like, come and they're, you know, they're okay, mm-hmm. and then they get super buffed, like, just abnormally buffed, and they become, like, super duper broken, so yeah. I wouldn't be surprised if she got a buff.
Oh, jeez. there was some Black Feather buffs that didn't make it into the first round of patch notes for whatever reason. Maybe they just, I think they were just skipped or missed because they've been crazy with all the live finals, but
right
it seems like he's very strong right now. And
you know, I actually haven't given that like too much attention, but yeah, I heard the same thing, like it's just this secret buff came in and now he's like super duper strong. I'm looking at it now, but I think it's mostly gonna be the Faint of the Heart is on a lower cooldown, and so that just makes him like a lot more fluid. You know, like it makes his playstyle like a lot different, I think, because he's constantly jumping around in team fights, and that's what I've like seen through gameplay of like higher elos.
Yeah.
But I also heard that, like, I was talking to Captain Nito about him at the live event, and I was talking to him about how like clunky he is. He was very very clunky because I felt like I couldn't really combo too well with him. And he said he did some changes on that, so I think it might be a mixture of a couple of things.
Yeah, he did have like an attack speed issue where stuff wasn't going off, so he feels a lot better to go in. I know I've been playing him a lot because I have a lot of fun playing with them, because you just kind of jump in there and people underestimate how much you're gonna do, how much damage. It's like, I'm just gonna go in, like, let's see what happens.
Yeah, and you just blow up their whole team, like, what just happened?
Right, it's kind of, he's just a lot of a risk reward kind of hero. It's like, yeah, let's see what happens, I'm doing it. I guess similar to what Rona kind of does.
Oh, for sure. Yeah.
So,
I think the difference between him and Rona is like for tanky though. Like, she just has abnormally like large amount of stats for tanking off of her A.
Yeah.
And so Blackfeather, I don't know, like he's a lot of fun because like you said, it's just kind of high risk, high reward, but I think he can do so much more in the right hands, you know. Like, I think he scales with skill like hugely.
Yeah, for sure. Have you guys figured out any good team comps you've been seeing with him? You don't have to give me any insider info, but who do you think, like, have you been running him in the jungle? Or I've been seeing him mostly in lane, like, because he can be a bully in lane with his faint, what, the point?
Yeah, the little B thing.
Yeah, this B.
And he gets a shield. To my knowledge, I think everybody I've talked to was saying how he's, like, really good in the jungle. Okay. I've been kind of taking, like, a week hiatus from, like, looking into things, because after the live finals and stuff like that. And to my knowledge, he's a really good jungler. But I think, he could be played in the lane just fine. Like, his kit makes sense for the lane and the jungle.
Yeah.
And I don't know, like, if people will start, like, doing lane swaps with him. Like, Glaive lane's strong, too. And so, you know, you could do, like, special lane swaps. But to my knowledge, I think he's better in the jungle.
Oh, okay. All right. I'll keep pushing him in the lane. I like him in the lane, but I'm fine. Like, I just click on him and I'll like go wherever he's needed.
Yeah.
It's like, all right, whatever. I think that's some of those best roles. It's like, well, I want to play this person and I will play jungle or lane. Like, who do you want to play? Kind of thing.
And it's really good for solo queue. Like, I used to play Glaive all the time in solo queue because like if someone insta-locked jungle, okay, I'll go lane. If someone insta-locked lane, I'll just go jungle.
Yeah.
It works out.
Nice. That's fun. 1.12 update, I think we may get like another fast turnaround. I know I mentioned like last time this patch kind of dropped at a weird time. We were getting like patches at the beginning of the month, and we got like a middle patch again. So
this is kind of weird.
I'm curious for this 1.13 at the beginning of the month, and then a 1.14 when the winter season begins.
Right. I think it's gonna be huge. Because honestly, like, I guess a couple of things change, but like to me, this patch seems like really small. I just get that feeling from it.
It seems like they wanted to get Kestrel out, get the new hero, get everyone excited for that. Make sure it got in before Apple went on vacation and maybe SMMC people went on vacation so they could all take a little break and enjoy the holiday. So just kind of like get that out, and the rest of the team will kind of finish up maybe what the patch would have been, like this big patch. I almost feel like they're doing these like two smaller patches now.
Right. Actually, I can definitely see that.
Mm-hmm. But the comps in 1.12, it seems like we're still figuring them all out. We haven't had that super OP meta comp come out yet. So I think people are still having fun with it and figuring things out.
Yeah.
Which is good, which is nice that we get patches faster, because those comps don't develop where you get tired of them.
Right. Like, okay, I think everybody was bored with Rinko Koshko Fortress.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's 1.12, and then along with the live finals and just the excitement of the holiday season, we got Double Glory Weekend.
Woo!
Yeah, this is happening for 3 weekends.
Yeah, I know, it's crazy. It's really Christmas season for sure.
Yeah, I think we got this last year around this time. We might have even had 3 weeks of Double Glory, not even weekends. But so we have a Double Glory weekend lasting from December 11th through the 13th. So by the time you hear this, it is over. Awesome. But you have another one Christmas weekend. So they're skipping next weekend and doing Christmas weekend, which is, I don't know why they skipped a weekend here. But
totally random. But hey, I'm fine with Double Glory whenever.
So December 25th to the 27th is the second one. And then the final one for this time is January 1st through the 3rd. So this should get you plenty of glory, so you can get Kestrel and maybe the next hero and get some of those skins that are coming out and lots of good stuff. I know I end up playing a lot. I have a couple accounts. I usually play on one of them, but I end up jumping on some of those other ones to be like, I need glory here because I spend all the money on this one. I need some glory on that one.
For sure. The grind.
Mm-hmm. And you could play I think I play casuals a lot more during Double Glory time, because you're just like, oh, let's practice people, let's get as many games in as I can
for sure.
See what happens.
It's always really
did this entice you to jump back in? You know, you said you were taking a break.
I'm playing a lot more casually. Like, I have a couple of friends at school who like always ask me to play, but I'm always like super busy, so I'm like just playing a bunch of games with them. I play like 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 games today. Just racking up the glory.
Yeah, it's nice. Yeah, and then you blow it all on like 2 glory boxes. It's all gone. Poof.
Yeah, racking up the cards for sure.
So that's fun. So everyone, get some games in, maximize your time. You know, spend with your family, and then get in there and play some Vainglory. The other thing that just ended by the time you're hearing this too is the EU live finals. So we were talking about the NA live finals, but the EU ones happened over the weekends as well. I got to watch a couple of the games. I think I saw a few on Friday and then one on Saturday, and I still have to watch the finals. I know who won, but I still have to watch the finals.
For sure.
Did you get a chance to watch any of these?
I know I glimpse of them every once in a while because I really like how EU plays. Like, I really like the weird picks they come up with. Like, maybe I don't agree with all of them all the time, but I think it's just really cool to see them like experimenting with different things and winning with them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. You want to mention the meta seems there to go a little later. They're safer.
Yeah.
More passive play. NA is like, we're gonna fight. Guys, let's just go in.
Yeah. I think they were like some of the first people to start playing like Sky a lot. Sky Petal, you know, Vox, they still play that quite often. And so yeah, they definitely have a more reserved kind of like, I'm gonna, you know, out objective you and I'll farm you and kind of scale up and just completely dominate you in team fights. Which, it, like, I agree, you don't really see that as much in NA. NA is really skirmish focused, you know, like in the jungle, constantly invading, you know, and then off of those skirmishes, they snowball to get the objectives. So,
right, because yeah, in NA, it's like you have a fight, you win a fight, you might be doing something, and then the team comes back again. Yeah, and they're like, all right, we're a fight. It's like, oh my god, no.
Exactly.
So. These games, you caught a few of them, but I felt like the time was terrible. Yeah. I get they were in EU. So, Super Evil, I think you need to take a lesson from Riot Games, League of Legends here, and start these games later.
For sure.
Riot starts the LCS EU games usually around, like, I think 5 or 6 o'clock there, and then they run until like midnight their time. Like, it's super late, but it happens to be like right as NA people are getting to work or starting their day, and that means more people can watch the game.
For sure.
These games were over by the time I got up.
Yeah. They started super early. Ridiculous.
It's like, if they started at like 9 a.m. even Eastern time or something like that, or even like, but they were starting, I felt like, at 5 a.m.
Yeah.
Something like that, for at least me. So I was kind of disappointed, and I have to go back and watch the VODs now, the Twitch videos, and which is a bummer because I know who won, and I can't like join in on the conversation on Twitch and like, oh, that play, all this fun stuff.
I mean, I think what they should do like next time is just rebroadcast it. Like, I think rebroadcast would be like so smart, because I mean, they're doing that right now for All-Stars. They did that for the the EU All-Stars too. I think it just makes more sense, because like, you can still participate, you know, in the hype, and then just don't announce too many things before the rebroadcast, you know.
Yeah, give us a second time. I understand they want to tweet it out and congratulate the winners and all that stuff, but I know I'm just like crying, like, boohoo me, I can't watch. I can't get up or stay up that late, whatever, however you want to do it. But I think they would get more viewership, because I saw the Friday games, like, they barely were breaking 1,000 views on Twitch, which is tough. Like, the audience, they weren't showing too much because, you know, it was Friday early there. I don't think they had a big crowd. Like, everyone from NA came out. Like, so many people live in California, so they were able to, like, have all these community people there, and just everyone was there.
For sure.
But not to, like, I think the stage and everything in the EU, like, looked great, so not to, like, devalue what it was at all. I just...
Yeah, it was still an amazing event, and it's still, like, really cool to see them, you know, put all this work into it. And, you know, I appreciate it just from, like, a player, a coach, you know, someone who's, like, a part of the community. Yeah. I think it's, like, really cool what they're doing, and I think it came out really well either way.
How is it, like, watching these games? Because you probably see a lot of NA games and people, like, NA stream. It seems more than the EU people. Like, I see a few streams, you see autocorrect, but seeing some of those players that maybe you can get some intel on is kind of nice, right?
Like, I don't really pay attention to, like, a lot of the streams nowadays, but definitely when, like, during the live finals and stuff like that, I'll check out some games. VIPL, I check out, because, you know, there's some NA teams there, so, you know, I scout a little bit.
Okay. Nice. So everyone go watch these. I believe I'm not going to spoil it here, but MediaPixel, who is the 8th seed, which is pretty fantastic, came back and took it all.
Mm-hmm.
That's a true underdog story right there. That's pretty fantastic. I don't know if anyone expected that. I think maybe SK was one of the favorites, or even Snow.
Yeah.
Was one of the favorites to win.
I thought SK was going to win. So yeah, MediaPixel winning was, you know, pretty big. Definitely a Cinderella story.
Yeah. How do you think, I guess we mentioned the meta, and how do you think the matchups would go? We've seen them a little bit in the VIPL, but the matchups of like NA versus EU, like, are we just going to say NA is going to win because we're in NA, but being biased?
You know, like, that's a conversation I always, like, you know, I think it's impossible not to talk about it, you know, but I usually just stray away from it, because I think everybody's meta is just so region-based, and it's so different, and I think when it really comes to international events, I think everybody starts adapting to things, you know. I always talk about inter-tournament meta. You know, there's just some picks that, you know, skyrocket in this specific tournament, but in the other tournaments, you don't see them as much. So
to me, I think NA is just has consistently performed better than EU in almost every single international event, like when you really think about it. And I don't know if that's just, you know, at that specific time, those teams, because I heard like at VIPL, the first one, that Red was actually supposed to be there, but there's some like issues there, or Red now SK. So yeah. I don't know. I mean, there could be issues around there, but that's just how I see it. I think consistently we've just performed better. So I think when push comes to shove, we'll just win because our meta is just a lot more aggressive than theirs and we can really abuse their meta.
Okay. Interesting. I would love to see Super Evil do like a invitational as well. Like, oh, now that Liberation won and MediaPixel won, maybe the top four teams, mm-hmm. they do like another tournament where, because they got their eSports, I guess, at their new office and their stage that they're setting up, so they won't have to like bother, like all this setup
for sure.
won't be as big, so they could maybe invite those people out for like a bigger like best region kind mm-hmm. of thing, which would be
that'd fun. Be really fun. And that, if they did something like that, I would want it to be kind of sort of like All-Stars, like the League All-Stars thing, where it's a little more fun, you know. Okay. Less super like diehard competitive, because I think we already have enough of those. You know, we have VIPL, we have the next Worlds that's probably going to come up soon, you know, the Live Finals. Yeah. So I want to see something fun, you know, because rivalry is cool to see in competitive play. But, you know, sometimes it's like we want fun rivalry. I think it's really important.
Yeah, that's right. I think there are people I see on Twitter who say there's not like a tournament for, I guess, non-pro players, which is a hard thing to say, because if you're in a tournament, you should be pro, yeah. or you should be trying to be. But you're right, there's not like a goofy like Ultimate Bravery.
Yeah.
Let's see who's the best at Ultimate
exactly,
Bravery.
Exactly, like 1v1 or something. I think that would be really fun to see.
Yeah, that's cool. So go back, watch some of these games. I'll probably catch the finals here sometime, maybe tonight as I'm doing some work. Mm-hmm. But yeah, go check them out. They're all on Twitch. And hopefully maybe they get them up on YouTube as well. So always a little easier to watch than Twitch's playback.
Right.
The last thing I want to mention in the news is the free hero rotation. I like mentioning it because we all don't have all the heroes yeah. sometimes. They're just a little too expensive or we just can't get to them. This free hero rotation is pretty good. So we have Fortress, Catherine, Fox, Jewel, Cruel, and Ringo. So Fortress, man, he was dangerous
yeah,
in 1.11. And I think he's still pretty strong here, but you need to just have learned to play him well and understand that aggression and like when you can back
yeah,
off.
Exactly.
I guess you can't just
run in their face anymore.
Yeah. I'm sure there's a lot of people who saw these Live Finals were like, oh, I got to play Fortress, and he's fairly new, so you might not have been able to pick him up yet. So I think being able to test him out here is really good, because he's a different kind of support.
Sure.
Like he fills that Roam role. Like the Roam
yeah.
is what he is. He's not the support. He's like, I'm gonna roam over here and kill this guy.
Exactly. Like he just will solo carry his whole team.
If you had to pick one of these, I guess six people for like a new player to like practice, or like the most diverse player like they could climb with, would you recommend one of these to anyone?
Ringo, all the way. Ringo, like Ringo. People underestimate him so much, and it's like when you have Koshka, who's definitely one of the strongest junglers in the world, like why not just play Ringo? He's like super duper safe. You can, if you get good at him, like he scales the skill, you know. He's not someone who you can only do like a little bit with, you know. Like Fortress can only run at people's face, you know. Ringo can do like so much more. He teaches you mechanics, you know. He's just overall really consistent here that I suggest to everybody.
Okay, yeah, let's see that. I love playing Ringo. I think I have to sometimes when I'm streaming, like I can't play Ringo.
Yeah,
like there's just like I like playing him so much, and I understand his kit because it's very easy to understand.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they're all clickable, they're no skill shots, so
right.
you just can you can understand it quickly, so it's
yeah.
nice.
Yes.
So check out that free hero rotation, and that's going to do it for the news, but I found a little forum static.
Forum static.
So in the forums, you even mentioned this earlier, like OP-ness, brokenness.
Yeah.
People sort of the thread just about like, hey, I think we need to stop using this. It is overused. As soon as I get wrecked or beat by someone, I'm like, oh, well, I lost because they're OP.
Yeah.
Is this a Vainglory thing, or is this just a general MOBA thing? Like, oh, I can't. Like, you're playing the broken heroes. Of course you won. Like, OP.
I mean, to me, like, it shouldn't matter. Like, if you really think it's not OP, just play it, you know? Like, I mean, this is coming from Magic. Like, Magic, you have the people who, like, brew their own decks, you know, like, really put, like, weeks and weeks of thought into these decks. And then you have the other people who are like, oh, what deck won the last tournament? I'll just grab that one. And that's kind of how I see it. You know, the people who like, okay, I guess the poop strats that you had, like the Warhorn comp, you know, stuff like that, Stormguard comp. Yeah, I can kind of see, you know, that's not really fun to play against, and it had like a crazy win rate. But when it comes to heroes and the items and stuff like that, I think you just need to embrace it and just play it yourself, and then you'll climb.
Okay, and either find out that it's OP or find out maybe that person was skilled at it, and you just... are not as good as them. Now they're not OP because you didn't win every game.
Right. I think there's like, it doesn't matter how OP something is, like there's always going to be like some type of counter to it or something you can do. Uh-huh. And like, you just have to realize that. And if you really do think it's OP, then, you know, really study it and see if there's a way to counter it, or maybe they were just better than you, or just play it.
Cause I guess I could, in the Vainglory, time I've been playing it, I can only think of like two things I feel like were definitely OP. That was Vox, 1.3 Vox.
Yeah,
he was like super strong, and people got to Vainglorious quickly with him.
Oh, yeah.
And then I guess two, three maybe. Tank Kashka, just being able to dive turrets all day. That was fun. And then Jungle Scarf, but that was just broken because it wasn't set up right. That wasn't OP. That was just him. Fan of Flames was ticking too much. So
yeah.
I guess those are my three that I think were actually maybe OP in our Vainglory time frame as far as heroes go.
But
I think it's a general MOBA thing to just say like, I lost to this, so they're OP. Like, you're just playing that meta or playing that hero, and so you have no skill. But so for everything to be OP in Vainglory, I think it shows that you have a lot of players that maybe don't play a lot of MOBAs or didn't. So they're new to this idea that like there's balancing and heroes change. And just because your favorite hero is good this patch might not be good next patch. And you have to learn new heroes because everyone changes and grows, and your skill changes too.
Exactly.
So it's tough. So maybe stop saying OP, everyone who's listening and out there. But head over to this forum and see a lot of people's thoughts on it. The forums are always a fun place to find what everyone's talking about.
Random item.
Last thing I want to talk about before we got here. This is a random item. So every now and then, we pick an item that we either see a lot of people using, or just to give you a little more insight into how an item works. And this item is, I picked Frostburn because this item people are saying is OP now. And you're seeing it almost on everyone right now. This is the item where it deals 100 crystal damage, and then you also slow enemies for 1.5 seconds. And then the slows increase by 10% plus the crystal power. So if you have like a shatter glass, that slow is just crazy. Yeah. The good part about this, if you got slowed by Frostburn, you can't be slowed again for 2 seconds, but you're probably dead.
Yeah.
if you get slowed,
then you're gonna get Catherine Sun, you're gonna get Kashka's gun, it's like it's over.
This item is almost the first item on a lot of CP carries now on your scarves, on your Celeste, black feathers. Like, it's just like, it's strong. I feel like 100 crystal power is kind of ridiculous for what the utility of this item deals.
Right. Like, the story about Frostburn was, you know, at one point it was like the worst CP item in the game because it just wasn't like stat efficient, or maybe it was, and like, it just didn't feel right. And what SDMC was like always promoting is like, sometimes Frostburn is useful, and I think like on Petal it was useful, and Scarf it was useful back then, in some scenarios, but they wanted to promote, you know, choice in CP items. Yeah. But then you had, you know, Shatterglass, everybody went double Shatterglass, then everybody went Eve. And then Eve was pretty much like the Frostburn that we have today. It was constantly built first, you know? And then all of a sudden we see it just get nerfed to the ground. And it's just not as strong. And Eve. Then, hold on, 1 second. Right, so do you want to like redo that one part?
I'll just come back with the Eve. So that's the Eve that got nerfed to the ground.
Yeah, so Eve got nerfed to the ground, and so alongside that, Frostburn was just getting like a little bit buffed, a little bit buffed, and then all of a sudden, like you know, we had this item that doesn't really promote choice anymore, and so you get a lot of CP, you know, 100 CP, and you also get this crazy slow, this crazy buff slow. And, you know, Eve's not that strong, so you just go to the next best item, that was Frostburn. And then people really started realizing that, you know, it synergizes with a lot of CP heroes, like Scarf especially. I think it's just crazy OP on Scarf.
Right, because so. You could catch people with those Fan of Flames, and they're slowed, so you're keeping up and getting that burn on them.
Yeah, you just melt their whole team.
But yeah, 100 CP when Shatterglass is, what, 150?
Mm-hmm.
Like, that... Why would like a 50 CP, like, yeah, if you're doing the numbers, it may be better, but having that slow is just so much better for everyone else to catch up. Sure. Like, I think we could kind of maybe take Frostburn down to 75 CP and it'd still be an okay item.
I think it was like around 70, 75 before, and that was when like Eve was super strong. So yeah, I got a little overshadowed there.
Uh-huh.
But I think 80 might be a good number. Like, I haven't really done the math. But I think 80 would just, it would not be a useless item CP-wise.
Mm-hmm.
And it would still, like, promote choice. Because I think that's what's really important about these type of items, is you're promoting choice. Do you need the slow more than you need the damage? Yes, go Frostburn. Do you need the damage? Then just go Shatter Eve or something like that, you know?
Right.
I think that, like, what's the point of having different items if there's not a lot of choice in between of them?
Yeah. I'd love to see an item that would, a cleanse item. I know we have Reflex Block and we have Crucible, but a cleanse from either a slow, so then I could cleanse and then use our Warhorn and get out of here.
Mm-hmm.
Like, as a support, like, I feel like that's an item we are definitely missing, and I would love to see it happen with the Vainglory 2.0 when that finally happens and we get some new items.
That and like aura items. I really want to see like aura items that just give your whole team a buff. I don't know how possible that is, but that's something I've been looking into.
So more, not so much like a Warhorn where that everyone gets it. It's more of an area of effect, kind of a healing in a zone kind of idea.
Something like that, or like, okay, in this zone, people have increased shield or increased armor or increased attack, you know, all types of stuff like that.
Yeah, that'd be interesting. And I wonder if they'd be maybe too strong because the map is so small.
Yeah.
But yeah, but... Frostburn, man, if you guys are playing a lot of CP heroes, I would highly recommend building this item and giving it some tries and tests and just seeing if you like it first or maybe second, but it should be in most kits at the moment.
Yeah, for sure. It's super strong.
Yeah. Well, that's going to do it for episode 67. Lots. Thanks for joining me.
Thank you.
Where can people find out more about you and Liberation if they want to, after they're done watching this?
So my Twitter is VGLots, so you can go ahead and go on there. And then Liberation's Twitter is LiberationVG.
Okay.
The application link is also on the Twitter, so go ahead and check that out. And I hope to see a bunch of applicants.
Right, and I think a lot of people in Liberation are on Twitter as well, so I think probably the Liberation Twitter account's following most of them and retweets a lot of stuff, so follow all those people over there and, you know, root for them. Hopefully we'll see you guys in the next VGL and even all these tournaments coming up. I know you'll have a lot of supporters behind you.
Thank you. Yeah, I really hope we make it too.
And then, so Shatter the Vain on Twitter as well, at Shatter the Vain. If you have any questions, tweet me there. I also tweet a lot of just my ramblings about Vainglory or any news that I come across. It's all shared there, so follow me there. And then the website, shatterthevain.com. All the episodes get posted there. Links to iTunes, Stitcher, YouTube, however you want to watch, listen to the show, it's there. And if you're on iTunes, please leave a review. I love seeing those. Let me know what you like about the show. You know, drop those 5-star reviews. Let me know why you're liking it, what you want to see more of. Helps make the show even better. That'll do it for episode 67. I believe we got the hot mess coming on for episode 68, so get ready for that. Take care.
Shatter the Vain.